I'm Dr. Egdan Rashad, and you are listening to the Psychopharmacology Institute podcast. Psychopharmacology Institute is an independent educational platform that aims to help you, the mental health clinician, prescribe even better. This podcast is here to do just that. Every 2 weeks, we cover interesting and clinically relevant topics that you can apply right away in your practice. Before we dive in, though, why don't you go to piupdates.com to sign up on our website, earn CMEs, and receive regular psychopharm nuggets of joy. PI stands for Psychopharmacology Institute, by the way. The title for today's podcast is, Do You Order Pharmacogenetic Testing? I realized that it could have two or more meanings depending on the emphasis. So here it is with the correct emphasis. Do you order pharmacogenetic testing? Should we do it? Is it worth it? Today, we will explore just that. Before we jump in, though, let's recap what pharmacogenetic testing actually is. Let's make this ridiculously simple. Pharmacogenetic testing looks at specific genes to help figure out the type of medicine and dosages that might be right for your patient. So it aims to help guide treatment. That was clear enough. This type of testing can be abbreviated to PGX. You'll hear some people calling it pharmacogenetics and others call it pharmacogenomics. Which one is right?
I should point out that when we use the term pharmacogenomics, it really is the same as the term pharmacogenetics. Pharmacogenomics is more of an updated term encompassing the whole genome instead of the traditional word pharmacogenetics.
That was Dr. Simon Kung, Associate Professor of Psychiatry at the Mayo Clinic in Rochester. He will be joining us today, as well as Dr. Michael Thase, who is a Professor of Psychiatry at the University of Pennsylvania's Perelman School of Medicine. I met Dr. Thase at the 2019 ASCP Annual Meeting in Scottsdale, Arizona. We have all the basics ironed out. Now let's get to the beef. Okay, first things first. Why would a diligent and cool clinician like you consider pharmacogenetic testing in the first place? Over to Dr. Thase.
So the best evidence comes from a study called GUIDED, published just a few months ago in the Journal of Psychiatric Research. There is a Canadian companion study that is nearing completion. So soon we'll see if things are the same on both sides of our border. But in the GUIDED study for patients who had a history of not responding to antidepressants in their current episode, the average advantage in response or remission rates was about 7 or 8% across the board. So I would say for starters, if you have a patient who has not responded to things that you think should have helped, a patient who's had unusual side effect experiences with medicine would be a group that I think it might be worthwhile to do it. I would make sure that your patient knows what the out-of-pocket cost is before ordering the test. You don't want them stuck for a large bill. And in my experience, not everyone who has a history of extensive and terrible side effects actually has metabolic variants. Some people are conditioned to experience drug side effects more dramatically than other people. And other people, whether or not it's conditioning, simply are more frightened or worry more about the experience, and they feel these things worse. So it's not all explained by pharmacogenomics, but there is a small proportion of people that having this information truly does make a difference for.
So to summarize, we can use it in a patient who is treatment resistant and or one who is experiencing unusual side effects. But note that not all patients experiencing terrible side effects have something up with their metabolism. And notice that we are talking about patients with depression here. We have reviewed what PGX can do. I wonder, what can't PGX testing do?
It can't tell you which medicine is going to be the most likely to help your patient. It can only tell you which medicines may be more likely to cause trouble, either through too many side effects or not enough drug exposure. And so, for example, there may be a day when all of this information is conveyed on a single chip, and it may cost $25 to have all of this information on every patient you treat. And even if it only made a small difference in the chance of the patient getting better, $25, most everyone would say this is worth it, even if it's 4%, 5% advantage. sign me up. But today, the retail uninsurance reimbursed cost of some of these batteries runs between $800 and $1,200. And so now we're talking about the cost of 3 months of treatment. So yes, it's possible that you could offset the cost of 3 months of treatment if you got it right the first time, but you'd probably need a large advantage on average, maybe a 20% advantage to truly offset a cost that large. So there's tension right now because the companies that sell these batteries present them in the most upbeat and positive way, but they're expensive and they're not universally reimbursed by insurance, and they're not really delivering 20% improvements for the average patient. It seems to be more in the order of 5, 7, 10% improvements. So there's tension about the cost in relation to the benefit.
So basically, genetic testing is not that genie in the bottle that will cure your weary TRD patient. It has quite a number of limitations, including efficacy and cost. I think this is a work in progress, and who knows, perhaps like Dr. Thase mentioned, sometime in the future, patients will come in with a microchip storing their genetic data. So you have a patient with treatment-resistant depression, and you suspect that perhaps the reason could be related to his metabolism of drugs. PGX looks at some of the genes responsible for metabolizing drugs, and it tells what kind of metabolizer your patient is. So what is it used for mainly? Pharmacokinetic or pharmacodynamic genes?
Both can be done. The evidence is stronger for the genes that help determine drug metabolism. But there are some genes that are relevant to drug action also. But the strongest evidence comes from the pharmacokinetic part. This determines blood levels. And of course, if you're a rapid metabolizer, you may not be able to get enough of a drug's blood level up to do the job. If you're a poor metabolizer, you may have too much and you may overshoot the target and have unnecessary side effects. So more drug exposure than is necessary.
Okay, so basically PGX has a pharmacokinetic arm and a pharmacodynamic arm. Good. This might sound a bit dumb, but please bear with me. Most people have their cytochrome P450 enzymes, right? What exactly are we measuring when we send off a sample for testing?
Now, it turns out that of the P450 enzymes, there are many polymorphisms. So these are not abnormalities per se, but this is just the natural variation in people. So it turns out that the 2D6 enzyme is highly polymorphic. When they've looked at the molecular level of the enzyme, there's over 100 differences that they've noticed occurring. And the 2C19, that's another enzyme we've got that metabolizes psychiatric medications. There's over 30 and so on. So a lot of variation in these enzymes.
Thanks, Dr. Kang. So frankly, we have polymorphisms, and PGX can tell us what flavor our drug metabolizing genes are. So I decided to get my patient PGX tested. What's the procedure actually like? Over to Dr. Thase.
The modern world is so amazing. You used to give a vial of blood, but now you can collect a modest amount of saliva in a tube, and there are enough loose cells in your saliva, they can get sufficient genetic information. And these are like your fingerprints. They don't change. There is genetic material that's changeable, but the genes we're looking at here, your profile today will be your profile 40 years from now also.
Wow, now this makes me thoughtful about really how stable these results are. I did read about needing to redo pharmacogenetic testing after a certain number of years. What's your take on this, Dr. Kang?
One thought about pharmacogenomics is, do the results change? Because when you think about it, DNA doesn't change. So if I do this test on a patient, do I need to repeat it in 5 or 10 years? Well, it turns out, even though the DNA doesn't change, the way our technology is set up to detect differences and new alleles, so that's always changing, and the new alleles are being discovered all the time. And sometimes we change our classification system of whether this allele causes fast or slow activity. I've seen two different labs with the same genotype reported that they classify the patient in two different categories. One was classified as normal and the other was classified as intermediate. So sometimes these changes will make it so that it is reasonable every 10 years, let's say, to do the testing just to see if there's any differences.
Interesting. So it seems reasonable to retest after a decade, if still indicated, of course. Next, I wanted to explore a bit about whether pharmacogenetic testing really does improve outcomes.
So years ago, if somebody asked, is there any evidence that this kind of testing actually improves outcome? The answer would be no. But in the last few years, there actually have been some studies. So the answer should be yes, there is evidence. Now, there's a caveat, though, that the evidence has its issues. In 2017, there's a very nice review in the Journal of Clinical Psychiatry where many of these tests, clinical trials for these pharmacogenomic panels was looked at. And all of the studies, it turns out, are funded by industry, which is not unusual because whenever a new product comes out, it's going to be the manufacturer of that product that spends the money to try to show its usefulness. In terms of these studies and the depression outcomes, one of the companies called AssureX, their product is GeneSight. There were two positive studies and then one study that was almost positive. And another company named GenoMind had a positive study, but it was just a retrospective study. And then Baycrest also had a study.
So Dr. Kung went further to elaborate on these study findings. I recommend you watch the full section available on our website. You'll find the link to this section in the references. But to summarize, what Dr. Kung is saying is that PGX testing has positive results. However, because these studies are funded by industry, there's a clear possibility of bias. You understand the limitations. However, patients oftentimes won't, unless you set realistic expectations and clearly communicate with them about it. What are some tips our experts have for us regarding communication?
What seems reasonable to tell patients, and this is what I usually tell patients. So I tell them that pharmacogenetic testing will tell you theoretically how your body metabolizes certain medications. It doesn't tell us which medications will fix your depression. And it doesn't necessarily explain why you have side effects or sensitivities to medicines. I've had many patients come in convinced that they are a different metabolizer type because of all the side effects. And when I do the pharmacogenetic testing, a lot of times they come back at a normal metabolizer. I'll also tell patients that the current evidence provides limited support for pharmacogenetic testing for P450, 2D6, and 2C19. Primarily because there are those CPIC guidelines and a lot of evidence backing that up, and that the serotonin transporter gene results can be useful as well.
So we tell them that one, genetic testing won't fix their depression, and two, it doesn't always explain why one is having side effects. Okay, so the report came back. How do we discuss this?
And so when the report comes back, then I will teach them what I can about their own profile, and sometimes that is, I know you or I had some beliefs about your metabolism maybe getting in the way of your drugs, but I'm really happy to say you have the most normal drug metabolism that I've seen this month. That would be the patient who has really no drugs in the red zone. Or I might say, well, we can tell why the one why mirtazapine didn't agree with you because look, it's here. You have an inherited difficulty with the serotonin 2 receptor, and that's why the mirtazapine caused such sedation or side effects. And so we'll stay away from that kind of medicine and go here. Now, here are three medicines that we haven't tried that don't seem to have any metabolic difficulty for you.
This sounds quite reasonable. Let's recap what we have covered so far. We studied together the indications of pharmacogenetic testing, understood what it measures and how it's done, and also how stable PGX results are over the years. We also covered how to communicate it to patients. Next week, we will continue our conversation on pharmacogenetic testing, delving into the specifics of how to use the results to aid clinical decision making, should you choose to use PGX. We will also be revising over the CPIC guidelines. I hope you enjoyed this podcast and got a well-rounded idea of what pharmacogenetic testing is about. In case you snoozed, here are the key points. Pharmacogenetic testing aims to aid clinical decision-making by detecting genetic polymorphisms in the patient's DNA. Pharmacogenetic testing can be used in patients with treatment-resistant depression and patients experiencing unusual side effects. It is important to set realistic expectations to patients about pharmacogenetic testing and to clearly communicate the results. Do you like what we do and want to learn more Psychopharm nuggets of joy? Visit piupdates.com and become a premium member already. We have a bunch of CMEs for you to collect. If you are a psychiatrist in the US, we also offer SA credits. You can also go to our website and join our newsletter to receive weekly updates delivered straight to your inbox. The following people participated in this episode: Dr. Flavio Guzman as a general editor, Andy Rode as the audio engineer, Paula Gonzalez as the project manager, and myself, Dr. Wegdan Rashad, as the host. We'd also like to thank Dr. Simon Kung and Dr. Michael Thase for being with us. Thank you for joining us in today's podcast. Until the next episode, goodbye.